See, that's what we're dealing with. The bright lights of freedom. The responsibility of freedom. How to walk free with God. See, the real gospel does something to you, and I'll show you that in a minute as we go through this process, that allows you to be free. Be in church with people teaching you and fellowship with other people, but you never get bound. It's a way to be in all of these. Now, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater and hate church, because church is right. But the men and women that took it over and hijacked it are the problem. So God is dealing with what? The problem. God doesn't hate the people. He wants the people. But he got to move the barrier between him and the people. There's a barrier between God and the people in these pulpits. Nebuchadnezzar's idol. Worship it, not your God. But now we're going to tie all this together now. You know, I don't teach this stuff and it don't all tie together now. Remember, we went from Nebuchadnezzar's idol to Adam's semen to the seed bed. Go over to Revelation chapter 17. There's a lot of other stuff I can tell you right now, but I got to do this in sequences because it's too... This, how this ties together is in a way that you got to take like a few months to get it all straight. You know what I'm saying? So we'll piecemeal it over the next month or two, or 2 or 3 years, or however long we down here, because this is a never-ending revelation. How can you get to the end of God? Just is. No beginning, no ending. And we're going to try to tell you all about God in 30 minutes. Oh, man, you'll be down. You'll spend a lifetime and never understand God. Totally. So Revelation 17, look at this. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither. I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sits upon many waters. Now what you're looking at is the what many expositors have called the harlot church down over the years. It's not Roman Catholicism by itself. Roman Catholicism is a component of it. The harlot church is a church that is worshiping the Antichrist and Satan. It's a humanistic church and it's man-centered. It has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, it hates Jesus Christ. But it appears to be a righteous church that serves Jesus Christ. Remember, it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4, there's another Jesus, another gospel, and another spirit. You know, I find in my walking around and talking to people who say they're saved, that people don't even know that's in the Bible. They'll talk about Jesus and I say, you know the Bible says there are two Jesuses, right? What you talking about, dude? This blasphemy, there's only one Jesus. That's not what the Bible says. The word another says there has to be at least two. There's a false one. There's a real one. One is soulish. One is spiritual. One is the Lord from heaven. One is the workings of a man's mind. One will dominate you and control you and debase you. One or the other one will exalt you and lift you up. One will bind you and one will set you free. There are two Jesuses. That's why people say, we baptize in the name of Jesus. You said a mouthful of nothing. The name does not mean literally using his name. In the name of Jesus means you're under the power of attorney of Jesus. You have a power of attorney. You have the ability to stand in his stead and do things in his stead, just like a person that's incapacitated signs a power of attorney to have you sign documents for them. In Jesus' name is not literally using that name. So when you baptize in the name of Jesus, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, use any one of those formulas. And if that's a devil that went out in that water, that's going to be a devil coming up out of the water. Because baptism in any name won't do the job for you. You got to have a change of character. It's genetic. You got to have a nature change. You got to come as nothing, knowing you need Jesus Christ with every fiber of your being. You can baptize a person and not even talk. Think about what I'm saying. Now you're idolizing the formula for baptism. You can dump them in the water, that heart is right, and they come up. Hey, that's deal done. You don't have to say a word. We make an idol out of anything. Anything. Man, a man will make an idol out of anything. We can stand a statue of a duck in the front of this place, and I guarantee you we could convince somebody to worship that statue. You see this duck? This duck has magical powers. If you rub his head and you spin around three times and face the north, money will come your way. You know, you it might take you some time, but you get somebody to believe that. That's the fallen nature. It's easily deceived. That's why people can stand and listen to Creflo Dollar call them Negroes, like slaves on a plantation. Tell you I'll jump in your face if you try to leave me, what he's saying. And I have a wreck. You don't find the word wreck nowhere in this Bible. It's sin. A wreck is when you back out the driveway and by mistake back into your neighbor's bumper. It's not when you get four boys, raise them from their youth, wait till they're 16, have sex with them, molest them, give them cars, give them money, take care of them, and then pay off the boys. The lawyer for the boys wanted a public apology. He refused to do it. So he had to pay more money. That's why the money went up. Those, because it wasn't his money. I'm such an astute pimp, I'll get more money. Because I got a lot of holes out of my play. I got a big stable. Now you're gonna say, well, y'all ain't got no business calling them pimps. I'm going to show you why they have to be pimps according to this Bible. Watch this. He says this whore sits on many waters. They called the harlot church a whore because the harlot church is governed by pimps, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication. And the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon, the Great, the Mother of Harlots and Abominations of the Earth. So this harlot church spews out whores and abominations, which are homosexuals. Remember the Bible says, for a man to lie with a man as he lies with a woman is an abomination. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, wherefore dost thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which hath the seven heads and ten horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition or destruction. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not, and yet is. And here is the mind which have wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. And there are seven kings, five are fallen and one is. And the other is not yet come, and when he comes, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, he is the eighth and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition or destruction. You know, the Antichrist is called the son of perdition, the son of destruction. And the ten horns which thou sawest, that are ten kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they that are with him are called and chosen, and they remain faithful. And he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest where the whore sits are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. Remember Nebuchadnezzar's decree? All the nations, all the tongues, all the people must bow down. and the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree, and give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city, which reigns over the kings of the earth. Go back to Nebuchadnezzar. That city is Babylon, because Revelation 18 begins with the fall of Babylon. So now you see, the center of witchcraft and sorcery and religious control is Babylon. The woman sits on seven mountains, seven heads of seven mountains. These are the seven empirical rulerships that have ruled the world. Beginning with Egypt, you come forward to Assyria, then Babylon, then Persia, then Greece, then Rome. And I believe the seventh empire that remained for a minute and then was done away. Remember, he said there have been five, one is, and then one is going to come and continue for a short space. I believe that empire was the Ottoman Empire. It lasted 470 years. It was disbanded after World War I. And those areas that were made of the Ottoman Empire became what we know now as Iraq, Iran, Turkey. Turkey is the center of the Ottoman Empire. Turkey. But every empire that ever was has a nation that still remains on earth that was the center of that empire. Egypt. Assyria, Syria. Babylon, Iraq. Persia, Iran. Greece. Rome in Italy. Did you see that Rome still exists in Italy? That's the center of it all. That's where it's been amalgamated, and the ecumenical movement centers around Rome. And the Ottoman Empire is now the nation of Turkey. What's common about all those empires? They all had a conflict with the Jews. They all hate the people of God. They all ruled over the people of God and tried to dominate them. That's the common denominator. Now, so that's where the woman sits. This beast with seven heads and 10 horns. If you go back, don't go there, but in Revelation chapter 12, you find that the beast was Satan. So the empires reflect the God of this world's kingdom. He uses empires to control the world. America is nothing but an offshoot from the Roman Empire. It came from out of Britain's loins. All it did was jump the ocean and established empirical rule in South and North America and Canada. You find what in Canada, North America, and South America? Spain, England, and France. It just jumped the ocean. Okay, now listen. In Revelation chapter 12, the beast had seven heads and 10 horns with seven crowns on seven heads. In Revelation 13, you find the Antichrist coming into power. That same beast again, but the beast has seven heads, 10 horns, with 10 crowns on 10 head, on 10 crowns on 10 horns. It changed from empire rulerships to a broken up kingdom made of 10 empirical rulers on the 10 horns. You see a reordering of the world. You see a new world order. Then it gives you significant elements of the beast in Revelation chapter 13 when it says this thing has, it was likened to a leopard, which is Greece, had the feet of a bear, which is Persia. This comes from Daniel's definitions of these kingdoms. He told you about the kingdoms of Daniel. It had a mouth of a lion, and the dragon gave him his power. Okay, the leopard is Greece, the bear is Persia, the lion is Babylon. That was the breakdown of these beasts in Daniel. And the dragon gave him his power. The leopard, Greece, the wisdom and philosophy of Greece. The bear, Persia, the military might of Persia.
the lion Babylon, that's the mouth, the witchcraft and the sorcery of Babylon. He's speaking to you. He's divining on you. He's a magician working magic on you. A church is a dangerous place. This is the stronghold and household of magicians. Now I'm going to show you some stuff now that these jokers in magic know, and they don't want anybody telling this, so therefore I love to tell it. Go back to Revelation 17. We got to microscopically break this down now for it to make sense to your head and get down in you real deep and slap you around driving home in your car and you can't sleep tonight. That's how we want it to be. He says in verse 2, this whore committed fornication with the kings of the earth. So that's telling you the whore is doing what? Interacting with the political system, the government. And the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. She was on a scarlet colored beast. That's representing the Adamic. A red colored beast. The word Adam in the Hebrew is Adonai's blood. Dom is blood. The A comes from Adonai. Adonai's blood. God owned his blood. He was God's son. The Spirit of God absorbed into Adam's blood. He was one with God in his image. That's his son. Trace Jesus' lineage back in, I think it's the Gospel of Luke. As you go back, you'll find that Adam, who was the Son of God, the beast is a metamorphosized Adam. What is it? Adam became the governmental systems of the world. Eve became the religious system. That's why it's male and female character. He was the one that had governance over God's creation. Eve was the life giver. You see how it works? Marriage, government, and religion. One is a governing power. The other is a worshiping power, a religious power. That's what a life is. That's why he called his name Eve, life. When you defile the man and he becomes decayed, selfish, self-absorbed, and a pimp, look how the woman metamorphosizes into a harlot, a whore. Every pimp, every punk, every sissy, every wimpy guy only accommodates whores. And he won't deal with you until he makes you a whore. You got to be a whore. Usher tells you. A lady in the street, a cook in the kitchen, and a whore in the bed. That's what he sings to you. Older women tell young girls that. That's what you got to be. Be a cook in the kitchen, a lady in the street, and girl, you got to be a whore in the bed. That's trash. That's garbage. That's the mind of a whore trying to make you one. This is why you got to stand up and not bow. You see why you can't bow? Said, lady, look, that's crazy what you're telling me. I'm not a whore, in or out of the bed, and my husband don't want a whore. I'm a lady 24/7. That's why you don't bow. That's how you don't bow. They're just always spewing trash out over you, and you're supposed to just go ahead and, well, yeah, yeah, praise the Lord, well, yeah. No, hold it. I ain't bowing to your trash. Creflo, it should have been a man at that church and say, hey, dollar, hold it, man. Shut this trash down. That's garbage what that guy's telling you from that pulpit. You don't go back to that trash. I wish one of you ushers would touch me. Put your hand on me. You're going to jail for assault. Because don't nobody have the right to put their hands on you. You call the police to carry me out of here. You touch me, this whole church going to be sued. And you have your say. That's a punk boy. He ain't gonna get in your face. I get in your face. Jump in my face if you want to, boy. With that trash you espousing, with that trash you telling, you jump. That joke ain't gonna jump in your face in the street. A woman addressed that guy down all by herself. She got the power of God because he ain't got no balls. Look what you standing with, man. It's time not to bow. It's time to be the one that's got the goods and know you got the goods. Why are you so emaciated? Why are you so incapacitated? Why are you so afraid? What you cowering in the corner for and you got the goods? The Hebrew boys, I ain't careful to answer you, buddy. I got a living God. You got a bunch of stone statues and wooden blocks and junk. You get this junk you carved out last week in your room. And I'm the one bowing. But I ain't got to it yet now. Wait a minute. The woman is drunk with the blood of the martyrs and the saints. But look at verse 2. She committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. It says she's riding a scarlet-colored beast. Now, here's what your mind would automatically do. You say, oh, she's riding a scarlet-colored beast. So like a horse, she's on the back of the beast and riding the beast down the street, right? That's how you've automatically depicted that in your mind. That ain't right. The beast is on his back with an erect penis. And she riding the penis of the beast and milking his semen and putting it in that cup and having the people drink it, and they drunk with the semen of the beast. She's drunk with the blood of the martyrs and the saints. But it don't say this when she's feeding the people. She's feeding them the wine of her fornication. That's why the man drunk the semen of those boys. I'm gonna show you this now. Watch this. That's what old Lord said. Watch this, watch this. See that joker there? But I'm telling you to watch this with both eyes open so you can see it. That joker putting you to sleep. I'm telling you to wake up. Awake thou that sleepeth, and God will give you light. So why do I say they're pimps? On the street, highline pimps, I see them at night. One guy got all his girls, big stable. Every girl got his name stamped in the base of their back. His name on their back. He'll show them. That girl, y'all pull up y'all shirts. And they proud of it. I belong to this joker. I can tell you his name. And all of them stamped their name in his back. That he going to take them to the tattoo man. And when you join this stable, and they're proudly walking through Buckhead, one of his girls. But that ain't what marks him. A pimp marks his stable with pimp juice. He'll have a male and female stable, homosexual pimps for the homosexual clients. And the homosexual guy that he got as a homosexual prostitute got to drink pimp juice. They got an energy drink in the store called pimp juice. What is pimp juice? It's the pimp semen. He yokes you to him by drinking his semen, because he's putting his mind into you. He can stand you on a corner and you won't move all night and rake in $500 a night because you drank that pimp juice. You've been driven out of your mind. It's sorcery. You got a big time stable with some real fine girls. Like this joke got some girls that would knock a joker down getting out of that brand new Mercedes he driving. The joker might show up in a Mercedes one night, a Ferrari the next, a Lamborghini the next, and he just Bentley the next, living in a $3 million home in his grandmama's name. The girls look like they could have won the Miss America contest because they got their minds. They devalued. They humiliated. They've been leveled to the ground. I don't care how you look. A joker can level your mind to the ground when you got no self-esteem, no self-respect, no dignity, no morality, no virtue, no honor, drinking that pimp juice. Highline girls go work these Buckhead hotels. Guys come through there and pay them $1,000 just for 30 minutes, an hour. Girl, be up. You got 10 girls. Live with between 8 and 10 guys a night. You talking about between $8,000 and $10,000 a girl, a night. That's why them jokers rolling so heavy. You try to figure out this town at night. You can't figure it out. the guys pimping girls left and right. They call them girls. You go by a strip joint, you don't see women, ladies, girls, girls, girls. They've arrested their development and made them girls. That's what they do from the pulpit. They arrest your development. They structure you and they incapacitate you, and they keep you bound under the fallen and Adamic race so as you can't live up to God's standards. You bow down. You bent over inside. You're laying prostrate before Nebuchadnezzar's image. Why? Because you've been fed pimp juice. Huh? Jesus said, my words are spirit and they are life. Where's the pimp juice flowing from? From that joker's mouth. You ingesting his words. It's bringing forth death. The devil's words are spiritual, but they are death. They separate you from God. Can't you simply be fed into Eve? He didn't literally have, he just talked to her. But he was feeding the pimp juice. She in turn opened her mouth and talked to Adam and fed Adam pimp juice. That's why you can rightfully call them pimps in the pulpit. Predatory pimps. Preaching prosperity pimps. Punk pimps. Let me tell you something. God is through. He always judges you out of your own mouth. When the man said, that's my brother, that's my friend, that sealed your fate. That's identification with that which is judged. Because he let it happen to judge him too. God is not playing. He's setting them up like dominoes. They're just like pins at a bowling alley now. Out of your own mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. And everybody with sense that knows God says, let me get out of here because he's coming through here heavy. And when he comes and strikes, I don't want to be taken out of the game. I don't want him knocking my head off. Semen is both physical and spiritual. Whores drink down the semen of a pimp. It incapacitates the mind and the soul. And the pimp uses you. But look what happens. You see how the ten horns hate the whore and destroys the whore? That's where they hit it. Because the Antichrist does not have a bride. He's totally self-absorbed and only loves himself. Just like the no good joker you met in the street, and you found that after a while, he don't care about nobody but himself. What you can give me, I drive your car. As long as you stay incapacitated and weak and lowly in your own eyes, like the spies that went into the promised land, it said, because we were ants in our own eyes, therefore to the giants we also appeared as ants. Because of your own self-evaluation, the devil will exploit you. Because I see myself as nothing, he can treat me like I'm nothing. That's what pimp juice will do to you. That's what's been done to these people by these preachers. Pimping preachers. Mac Daddies and Bentleys now and Rolls Royces and flying Lear Jets. Getting all their resources from the people they're pimping and then calling them Negroes and spitting in their face at the same time. Giving them their butts to kiss. And the people sit there applauding their own demise. It's bad when a joke can get you to applaud and say hallelujah and praise the Lord to your own destruction. But guess what? God's got your dirty number. He's got your number. He's going to come through with a reformation to reform the church outside of that hell hole and raise up people that don't want to be pimped. I'm going to tell you now the secret and the key to and the safety valve that secures you never to be pimped, never to be used, and never to see yourself in a bad light. You're going to be scot-free. Ephesians chapter 5. So you can be made whole. See, an insincere pimp won't tell you this. Because he needs you to need him. See how the man says, that man taught you how to tie your shoes. Man, I've been knowing how to tie my shoes for 30, 40 years. He's nursed them up and raised, like he's their daddy. And along had the people calling them daddy. Big daddy, papa daddy, pimp daddy, swag daddy, whatever. What you calling this joke your daddy for? The Bible says, call no man your father on this earth, because you have one father and he's in heaven. That's an abomination for somebody to call somebody their daddy. And to be so incapacitated and so beat down and so pitiful that you cowering down under this homosexual spirit. That's bad when you up under a homosexual spirit and worshiping it. That's rock bottom. I'm just telling you like it, T.I.T. is. All right. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it? But he also descended first unto the lower parts of the earth. So people say, well, Jesus didn't go to hell. That ain't what the Bible says. He went down and he preached the gospel. He proclaimed. And he led the captivators captive, the Bible says, and gave gifts unto men. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. He went down and then came up again to fill everything up with himself. So he says, all power has been given unto me. I fill up all things. David said, if I make my bed in hell, thou art there. You can't get around him. You can't get away from him. Man, I got your dirty number. Now listen, look at this. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of silly doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to do what? To deceive you. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Here's your safety valve. All you got to do is do the work of the ministry. The fivefold ministry gifts are not ministers. They're called gifts to equip the ministers. Yes. You are the minister. Yes. You do the work of the ministry. Yes. There's no professional vocational ministry. You are the ministry. Yes. You are the proclaimer. You are the preacher. These signs shall follow them that believe, not some ministry. You talk with new tongues. You cast out devils. You lay hands on the sick. You eat or drink any deadly thing. It won't harm you. You freely receive. You freely give. Yes. That's your safety valve. Yes. When you become vertically attached to God, you have the Holy Ghost leading you as a son of God. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they're the sons of God. You won't have anybody over you, dominating you, and pimping you, because the Holy Ghost is using you. And a real person that's teaching you the gospel, a real called ministry gift, is not offended by your freedom, is not offended by your liberty, is not threatened by you, because he has a personal relationship himself. I don't need you to verify me and validate me and affect me and to give me kudos and pat me on my back with attaboys. A fivefold ministry gift is equipping the saints to do the work of the ministry. The cursed thing is to sit somewhere in theater-style seating in a stinking hellhole of a church, getting entertained every week from a pulpit by a motivational speaker that's pimping you, filling your soul with pimp juice. And now you're captivated. You're mesmerized. You're hypnotized. You're bound by a sorcerer. The Chaldeans, Nebuchadnezzar's boys. And guess what? They're systematically building in you a hatred for the Jews. And you're not a Jew outwardly. The circumcision is inwardly, in the heart, not with hands. They hate the church. That's why when you tell them this is garbage, they hate you, because the pimp juice is talking. The pimp is talking. My pimp said, hey, look, if they come against me in this stable, you stand up for me now. The man said, why'd you leave your preacher? You ain't assigned to no preacher. Show me that in the Bible. What you supposed to sit there as a little kid under this joke and the rest of your life as a little kid with your little daddy preacher? Especially if I find a man, I'm liable to slap one of them jokers upside the head. Man, what you doing, man? You got your whole house sold into slavery, being pimped by a pimp on a plantation, seeking his approval, trying to be an armor bearer and carry his Bible down the aisle every time church opens up and carry his cup. What's wrong with you? The head of every man is Christ. The head of Christ is God. The head of the woman is the man. You don't have the right atmosphere in your home, man, because you sold your family into slavery. You sold your whole birthright for a bowl of pottage, man. That woman riding that beast in Revelation is on top of that beast, fornicating with the beast and siphoning the pimp juice that's necessary to feed the people, so the people will be bound by the beast. It's religion working hand in hand. The beast system uses the whore, and the whore uses the beast, and the beast system solicits the whore to feed the people the pimp juice, so they stay drunk, they stay high, they stay crazy with their eyes closed, drifting around in darkness. So you take out your 30-year mortgage, so you get a car loan for 7 years, so you're in credit card debt, so your interest payments are always kept up. So you're out there living crazy, drinking the liquor. You're gambling and trying to play the lotto. You're going to the mall and spending all your money on their junk. You're paying $5 for gas. That's what it's all about. Let me tell you something. Stop looking at people in sin and folks doing stuff in this world. The shake dancers, the drug pushers, the drug addicts, the adulterers, all that's nothing but something that's nothing but limbs and leaves and bark on the tree. The root of that tree is that stinking fifth of hell hole of a church down the street or around the corner where those jokers are spewing out that pimp juice to make sure the people stay like that. A lot of those same sinners that clubbed all night Friday and Saturday night are sitting in those churches and don't feel 1 ounce of conviction. You don't come into the real church of God and not get convicted. I don't know how long you've been saved. You can be saved 30 years and still get convicted, because you can't measure up to the standard of Christ. Christ could tell you something tomorrow morning that's going to convict you, and you've been saved for 50 years. This thing is diabolical. It traces back to the Garden of Eden. It traces back to that serpent spewing pimp juice in the Eve, defiling that man's bloodline, his semen, defiling a man genetically. And you see it revelated in the last book of the Bible, where those two people, Adam and Eve, have metamorphosized through the scriptures. You see them flash when you see Samson and Delilah. You see them flash again, David and Bathsheba. You see them flash again, Ahab and Jezebel. You see them flash again, Herod and Herodias. And finally, you see the beast and the whore that was birthed back in the Garden of Eden. Guys are walking around as vagina worshipers because they've been fed that pimp juice. Whores, by definition, are solicitors. They search for the unstable soul full of lust. Highline strippers will tell you they work the room based on the lust in the room. They solicit table dancers based on what they see been watching them all night. Guys in the strip joint, high rollers with $30,000 and $100 bills on the table. That girl working to make it rain. So making it rain means you rain their money raining on you. And them guys be just throwing money at her. At the end of a dance, she pick up all the money off the table and off the floor. Like a dog. They'll throw it down while she dancing and throw it on the table. Can't you see these people as these pimps are preaching, coming and throwing their money on the pulpit? What's he doing? He making it rain. Making it rain. That's telling you he's a hoe. Talking to hoe. Being pimps. Because all a pimp is a homosexual. He using the women for himself, using them to extract life out of them so he can live. He don't care what, he don't care. He don't care. You're going to be with 20 guys tonight. He don't care. Hoe, get out there and bring my money in here. That's a homosexual. A self-lover is what a pimp is. And the people sitting up under this and looking at this joker, calling them names and spitting their faces and cheering them on. Because whores will fight for their pimp. Because you got to understand, they're exploiting the fact that the people are incapacitated. If you touch this pimp, I don't know what to do. See, the only stability I got is the master as a slave. If Mr. Charlie dies, what we going to do? You seen Goin with the Wind. Miss Scarlet got all those black folks on her back. So I know how to bring a child into the world, Miss Scarlet. I can deliver a lot of babies. They said, well, go up there and deliver that baby. I don't know why I told that lie. And Miss Scarlet said, bam, you old fool. Y'all seen Goin the Wind, haven't you? That's what's in church. You said that joke a pimp. No, he ain't. That's a man of God. You got to slap him upside down. Wake up out of that coma. Awake thou that sleepeth so God can give you light. The slaves and the stable of whores don't want anything to happen to the master or the pimp. Because I'm so incapacitated, I dropped out of the ninth grade. That's why I'm out here whoring the street. I got no skills. I can't get a job. I don't know what to do. Mac Daddy, I live in one of his apartments. He feeds me. He buys me the clothes. Yeah, I work hard every night and I lay up with about 10 guys. But hey, I don't know what else to do. I've been pimped. I've been holed out. I'm incapacitated. Don't challenge me to think. Don't tell me to study to show myself approved, a workman needing not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. Don't tell me I'm the minister. Don't tell me I got to lay hands on the sick and cast out the devils. Don't tell me it's for me to go out there and freely give and freely receive. Don't make me accountable. Don't make me responsible. I'm just a hoe. Talk to Superfly. Talk to the Mac. Young girls have been just totally just ruined nowadays. Sit listening to these stinking pimp spirits coming through these rappers. Till they think it's something glamorous to be a hoe. I want to show my breast to everybody. The butt is now the new face. The butt is now the new beautiful face. You used to look at your face and you have a beautiful face. Now you got to have a big round butt. To the degree I even wear booty pop drawers. You don't see them on TV advertising them booty pops? The butt is the new face. They'll even see your face. She got a big old, look, have you seen her butt? You see that girl butt on the third floor? Man, look at that. They don't say look at her or she's pretty. Look at that. Man, a big old butt.
the butt is the new face. I don't even want to see your face. I just want, let me see your butt. Yeah, I want to go out with you. You look good. I was checking out your butt. And a butt don't have a gender. That's why the boys got their pants pulled down so they can show everybody their butt. Because they are sissies, homosexuals, freaks. A girl at a young age has to raise the bar. And so I refuse to be holed out. I refuse to lower my standard. I'm not going to let you spit in my face. We were talking Friday night about fear of the devil. The devil coming in your room and the devil doing stuff to you. The devil trying to stand over you at night and the devil trying to ruffle your sheets and the devil trying to make noise in your house. The devil walking through your house. You hear the footsteps in your house. That joke ain't got no power. The Hebrew boy would tell you he ain't got no power. The fire don't have no power over me. You got to get this. See, this is not good enough for me to say it. And you just say, yeah, amen. It's got the process in you so deep that this becomes you. I'm not going to bow. I'm not going to bow. I'm not going back to the law. See, going back to the law is bowing. I'm not studying the Sabbath. I don't care about paying tithes. I'm not bowing. I didn't just get free. I want to stay free. Creflo Dollar is pitiful. Eddie Long is pitiful. It's heartrending. Because when a person is pitiful and don't even know how pitiful they are, that's the most pitiful thing of all. When you are actually just hollowed out inside and people looking at you and thinking that you're crazy and you think you're being dynamic. The folks are looking at you and saying, you look so silly and what you're saying is so stupid. And you think it's just so deep and intellectual and you got the word and you just preaching something that's so dynamic. Because those whores in the congregation cheer you on. Because they don't want you to leave. They don't want you to be disempowered. Because I don't know what to do. Because I'm a hoe. And I got to have a pimp. They've given you the money to keep you sustained. Because I'm in the stable. And I don't want this thing to dry up because I don't know what to do without my pimp. Can't you see the parallels? And that pimp on the street systematically makes his rounds amongst his stable. And he makes sure he call out a girl every once in a while and hang with him. So he can make sure. And she drinking down that pimp juice. Just drinking that pimp juice. Make sure you drink it all down now. All right, now get on up and go on back out there. And they do it every Sunday morning and every Wednesday night on schedule. I wish you was pretty. I wish I was able to say nice things and give you platitudes and come across as a sweet tiptoe to the tulip guy. But I ain't got on no lace drawers. I ain't got on no pantyhose. And I ain't got on no heels. And I sure ain't wearing no thong. It is what it is. Now my wife said this morning, you know, I came to the fruition dealing with God. It is what it is. Whatever is in front of me, that's the hand I'm dealt. I got to play it. They don't say you wishing. I wish it wasn't like this. I wish life, and you might wish to forget rid of that wishful thinking. It is written. And feed your mind on that until you get a strong constitution and you're able to stand up under the fire and not bow down. It's a lot more to this that I'm not even able to, I can't even touch a lot of this stuff yet because it ain't enough time in a day to deal with all this. But know this, the Antichrist is banking on what I'm saying today being embedded in a soul. You're cheering on Barack Obama. He sold out to the New World Order and the Illuminati. That joker don't care if you live or die. I don't care if he's black, white, green, or purple. It ain't racial. He could care less about you. This joker sitting up in Congress sending his pictures of his penis out to women all around the country. Sitting up there talking about he's going now into treatment because he's sick. Man, step your rusty butt down and get out from up there. You looking crazy. Your wife pregnant. Hadn't even been married a year. And you out here crazy, driven out of your senses. The homosexual spirit comes in a multitude of ways. Tyler Perry, B.B. Winans, Kurt Franklin, all these folk running around trying to pretend they're pretenders. And it's bathing the people in that homosexual spirit. And then the people who've been bathed in it, who've been driven out of their minds, telling you, you can't judge. They drunk, they're like, you can't judge. You can't nobody got the right to say nothing about this, because we can't judge. They're drunk. You can't judge if you're drunk. But he that is spiritual judges all things and the judge of no man. Paul said in the church, I'm looking at you from afar. I'm seeing you in a vision. And there's nobody there qualified to judge this thing. Why do you go before law to judge it? There's nobody in the church to judge amongst you. What's wrong with you? Now they're telling you, you can't judge. Know you not that we'll judge angels? And you can't judge these small matters in church. Put this joker out from your midst. Don't even drink with him. The apostle didn't play. He come through. I tell you what you do. Demons have forsaken me. Forget him. Mark Alexander the coppersmith. He withstood my words. He didn't miss no words. And now we got, you can't judge. You can't, you gonna go to hell. Now he gonna go to heaven. He gonna make, but you gonna go to hell for standing against it. It's how you treated me. That's what's going to matter. And you sitting there, amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah. And the guy feeding you pimp juice. I'm telling you, there's no devil like a religious devil. And I stress to young girls, I talk to young girls all the time, I tell them, look, get some backbone in you. And stop groveling at the feet of these punky, sissy-fied, weak-kneed guys. Tell them to get out your face and stop talking to you. And go with God. And you'll meet a man down the trail. Why should you downgrade yourself to live down to the status of a punky, wimpy, whiny-nosed, sissy-fied little drag when there's a man down the trail? But you got to be forged into a woman first. That's the only holdup. You can't accommodate and join to a man until you're a woman. From the womb of man, male and female, a couple because they copulate and couple together. You can't do that as some kind of emaciated, dried up, rejected, incapacitated girl who don't know where the front door is, scared of a shadow, and don't know who she is, what she is, from whence she came. You got to be made whole. I don't, look, the biggest misnomer on this earth is this. Folks want to psychologically babble about their problems. I'm fornicating. I can't stop. I don't know why. Can you help me? No, I can't help you. Stop. I ain't to psychoanalyze you. I don't care nothing about you talking about you fornicating. Stop. No psychological problem. That's you doing what you want to do. Well, the demons. They deep. See, they ain't no demons. That's you. I ain't seen no demon doing what you doing. You did it. Show me the demon that did it. You did it. There ain't no expunging of willpower from you by the devil. I don't care how hard the devil comes. Nebuchadnezzar got a furnace burning 7 times hotter than man can bear. And the boy said, I ain't going to bow. He ain't overriding no willpower because he can't. Stop psychoanalyzing sin. We going back to the old landmark. I'm going to find myself an old man driving a car and I'm getting in the back seat. I'm saying, where you going, old man? Back to the old landmark. Back to the old pathways. What we call a spade, not an agricultural instrument. See, all that's over. All that psychological gobbledygook. All of this soul examination. John and Paul of Safford and all this working out the intellectual, soulish problems. Look, Ted Bundy, Charles Manson, Jeffrey Dahmer, heinous crimes committed. You don't see no court trying to figure out why they did it. Well, we have to psychoanalyze it to see. We came back with a death penalty. He's got to die. Ted Bundy dead tonight because he raped those girls and killed them. Nobody evaluating all the psychological gobbledygook in your crazy head. You do exactly what you want to do every time on time. And when you were out there sitting, you were on time at the club. You were the first one in there. You was ordering drinks. And you was on the dance floor like a dog, dancing like a mad dog and crazy. And you were the life of the party. Everybody couldn't wait till you got there. And you were doing what you wanted to do. I like this. You didn't feel no remorse. You couldn't wait to go. You was Friday night. You couldn't wait to go again Saturday. And now, I don't know why I keep fornicating. I don't. I rebuke you, devil. You done gone all the way down to the hotel. You done took off all those layers of clothes in the wintertime. You done went in the back room and took your pill. You done did all this stuff. You done bought the thong and the stuff from Frederick of Hollywood to wear that night. You done all this stuff now. And I don't know why I'm falling, okay? I don't know why. The devil, I can't stand the devil. Man, you crazy. Look at all the precursors to sin. Look at all the preparation for sin. You raise a boy from his youth to his teenage years until he's accountable. And then seduce him. And you had a wreck. Man, look. Let's stop playing. Let's stop accommodating. Let's stop downgrading. If you're a high school student, go into high school and know who you are. Care how many girls crazy and having sex? Look, I'm not going to depreciate myself that way. Eat lunch alone. Walk the hallways alone. Don't share your locker with nobody. Be the outcast. Be the ostracized one. Go through 4 years of high school like that and let it shape and mold you in the fire. By the time you hit college, man, you are a self-contained, godly unit. I don't need nobody. I don't need these guys hollering at me to make me feel like I mean something, like I matter. See, God will bless you with a nice figure. But that ain't got to be you. That ain't got to identify you. Your butt don't have to define you. Your breasts don't have to define you. Your hair, your eyes, your lips, they don't have to define you. You're going to be whole from the inside out. Be good looking. Dress nice. Fix your hair. Feel good about yourself walking down the street. But I don't need no outside inputs to verify me, to validate me. I don't need that, man. You're barking up the wrong tree. So when you come in my face with that trash, and you talk to a guy like you a woman, and you got a little punk, little old jive time player in front of you, he can't stand in your presence. Because he come to me, hey, shawty, hey, baby. And you say, hello, sir, how are you doing? That joker threw right there. Good afternoon, sir. You standing there 20, he 21 years old. Hey, shawty, what's up, man? Hey, baby, look, what's going on? Good afternoon, sir. How are you doing this afternoon? That joker threw right. He down the street right now. He can't handle that. And every time he asks you a question, yes, sir. What are you doing? You show respect for the man he should be. Talk to a lady with respect that's used to being a girl that's been trashed out. She can't take that. Yes, ma'am. Why you calling me ma'am? Because I'm respecting the woman you should be. I'm addressing you like you should be, not like you are. I'm doing what the prosperity guys told me to do. I'm calling those things that be not as though they were. What kind of a... Look. It's time not to bow. It's time to let this devil know this is the end of the road. Can't you see God has judged them? That's already being judged. When you come preaching that, you're already judged. Your mind is blinded. Everybody that God called out of there, believe me, this Sunday morning, they're out of there. They didn't go back. The chosen. Remember, those that come with Jesus are called, chosen, faithful. They might have been deceived for a while, but believe me, the blinders are coming off, and God is about to raise up some places for them to come to. And fool me once, shame on you. You fool me twice, shame on me. Those folk gonna become out hardcore. All I caution them to do is not to get a bad taste in your mouth about the fivefold ministry gifts in the church, because you set up under the false because of what was in you. Don't blame folks. Everybody didn't go to it. You did. How are the people sitting outside of it can see it telling you all along the trail that's wrong, and you fought them, and now you heartbroken, now you see it. Don't blame the real church for you sending the false one. Get in the real one and get yourself washed clean. Get yourself sanctified. Get yourself filled. And go out and be a minister for God yourself. A real fivefold ministry gift is not intimidated by people. I get people call me and write me all the time with all kinds of belief systems, all kinds of questions. I'm not intimidated by what they believe, because I know what I believe. I know whom I believe. I'm persuaded he's able to keep that I've committed to him against that day. I don't have to be worried about what somebody else believes. A lot of folks bring energy to try to make me believe what they believe, and I tell them, I don't believe it like that. But if you want to believe that, it's fine with me. I could teach a person the gospel for 20 years, and they'll say, well, I don't, Pastor Price, I don't believe it like that. Go with that then. Go with what you believe. What's it doing to me? Nothing. It's not about being right. It's about being righteous. If you're righteous, if you're seeking the Lord for real, with a sincere heart, he'll correct what's wrong. He'll make you righteous. That's why you don't debate it. If you're for real, he'll get you right. But if you ain't for real, you can't get right. You'll be a hypocrite and a play actor your whole life, trying to look like, act like, fit in, come across there, say the right words, dress right, sit right, talk right, and all along you're wrong, because it's genetic. You can put a long dress on a pig and it's still a pig. You can put lipstick on that pig, that's just a pig with lipstick on. It's genetic. Outward changes don't affect the inward program of what you are. In review, he was after the seed bank. He got to the semen. He genetically altered what man was. Man fell, spiraled down into corruption. Jesus came as the gene, the genus. Jesus came to restore that which he took not away. He repaired the damage done by eliminating the damaged being, Adam. He caved in and crushed his skull while the serpent just bruised his heel. When this thing comes back at the end of time, the deadly head wound will be healed. That's what he's talking about, a resurrected Adam. As a demonic entity comes from the bottomless pit and gets into the Antichrist. And the deadly head wound, Adam's head wound on the cross. He wounded his head on the cross. Golgotha, the place of the skull. Skull Mountain. Two languages used there, the Greek and the Hebrew. One language is Golgotha, the other one is Calvary. Both of them mean skull. If you see the mountain right now in Israel, you know what you're going to see? A mountain that looks like a face of a skull on the front of it. It's got two eyes, a nose, and a mouth. Right now, today, you can see it on the internet. Look up Calvary and pull up the picture. You're going to see a skull face looking at you. He bruised the serpent's head. His son, Adam, that he had defiled genetically, Jesus crushed your skull. He just bruised his heel because he's going to be resurrected again. At the end of time, the deadly head wound will be healed. And they all will wander after the beast. This is why right now, you got to be expunged from the damage done by these pimps. The literal physical pimps you were with and the spiritual ones. Your boyfriend in the 10th grade was your pimp.
Your old college boyfriend, your lover, when you thought you were shaking it heavy and doing some things, telling some things, he was your pimp. You joined yourself to him. The Bible says every sin is from the outside of a man. It's that one thing. Saving for the sin of fornication. Know you not, he that commits fornication sins against his own flesh. You join yourself to a harlot, you become that harlot. You join yourself to the harlot church, you become one with the harlot, the whore that sits on that mountain in Revelation 17. It's on now. I was born for this. I was born for this moment. I've been waiting for this mess to fall, because I know the fall of Babylon, when he said, cries out in Revelation 18, Babylon has fallen, has fallen. Man, that's what you're waiting on, because people are set free. They're searching and wondering now. All God has to do now is stand up in his church. And then what will happen is Isaiah 4:6 will come into play. He'll build a place that will be a covering, a refuge, a place of shade and covering from the rain and the elements of this world. And he'll nurse these folks back to health. And once he does, you're going to have an army that cannot be stopped, because they're going to remember what they came through. They're going to remember the damage done to them. They're going to remember all the tithes that pimp took from them. And you know something? Vengeance belongs unto the Lord. But it's something to be said about a person that's seeking vengeance against the devil. I'm not called to fight people and have and seek revenge against a person. But he didn't say nothing about the devil. If I get my hands around the devil's throat, I'm free to squeeze until my hands come together and his head blows up like a balloon and it pops. He didn't say nothing about that. God's not going, no, don't do that to the devil. No, hold it. I can do this to the devil. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested in the flesh, to destroy the works of the devil. He's feeding them heavy pimp juice. They're drinking the semen of that stinking, filthy, fallen angel. It's coming by way of words. Don't bow. Don't bow. They're going to tell you you're judgmental. They're going to tell you you're unloving. They're going to tell you you're homophobic. They're going to tell you you're intolerant. They're going to tell you all this stuff. Don't bow. Stand up like still and say, look, no matter what you say, you better come out of this mess and get yourself straight. Because judgment stands at the door. You can be calm, cool, and collected when you say it. Because the truth carries its own power. You got to yell the truth. You can say it monotone. It's got self-contained power. It's time to pray these folks in. When Zion travails, sons and daughters will be birthed. We got to travail for the sake of these people's souls. I pray for Eddie Long and Creflo. I've been praying for them for years. But I can't make them get right. At some point, see, God will bring it to a head, because he can't afford to sacrifice up a million people for the sake of one or two. He'll deal with them if they won't yield. You see it in the scripture many a time. He deals with a person for a long time. When they don't yield, like Saul, he had to cut his throat and move on. That's not God's first choice. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to salvation. I didn't come into the world to condemn the world, Jesus said, but that the world might be saved. So if a man stands up against God, adamantly refusing to bow down to the true and living God, he judges himself. He judges himself. But whatever you do, please don't bow. Because Nebuchadnezzar's image is standing up. It's marked with 3 sixes. And it's telling you, sell your birthright and bow down to the culture, the music, the programming. All this stuff is spewing out. They work sorcery all day. You don't know how much stuff is attempting to program your mind right now. All day, from sun up to sundown, subliminal messages are going forth all day to make you buy something, drink something, dress a certain way. When young people see the styles on Disney, they try to emulate those styles. That's why your daughter will come downstairs looking like Hoochie Mama. Cause she's trying to be Selena Gomez or Nicki Minaj or somebody on TV, Raven Simone. They infiltrate their minds. They use pretty girls cause the girls want to look pretty. See, they're not gonna use somebody ugly. You can say a lot of things about Ciara, but you can't call her ugly. You can't call Beyonce just ugly. Beyonce ain't ugly, man. Stop. You know, you talking about, well, I ain't full of no lust. Beyonce's ugly. No, you trying to fight lust by calling Beyonce ugly. Beyonce ain't ugly. Now, you need to get the lust out of you. See, that's stupid. See, that's a guy trying to be, all of them ugly to me. No, they not. You lie. Because the devil ain't using no ugly folk. He ain't using no ugly guys. Stop, man. Stop kidding your crazy self. You can't fight this warfare the fake way trying to flex for people to look like, because you're gonna be right around the corner with some gal next week trying to talk about they not ugly. Or they ugly or whatever. Man, come on, man. Stop. He uses pretty girls because the young girls want to look pretty and they identify with a pretty girl. I want to look like her. Well, look at her hair. They got their weave just like Beyonce. It falls just like her. Beyonce got all that wig and weave on her, and you got the same model. They got Beyonce wigs at the store. You go down to the beauty show, they got Beyonce wigs. And you, that's the same color, that blonde color, blonde streaks, just like Beyonce. How much is that? That's $200. Well, let me put $100 on this week, and I'll pick it up next week. Now you at the club, and in your mind, you're talking about all the single ladies. Looking, trying to be Beyonce. You are Beyonce. The guy walking down the street with it, that's Lil Wayne. Then somebody say, no, man, you look just like Lil Wayne. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. It's a compliment. I didn't mean that as a compliment. I was just saying you look like Lil Wayne. And in other words, you tore up. You look crazy. You're ruined. You're just through. I don't even know what. He said, thanks. You know, I thought this outfit I had on, I thought it was Wayne-like. You know, look, y'all, don't bow. For the sake of these people's souls, don't bow. See, if you bow, what hope do they have? If the righteous scarcely be saved, where in the world will the sinner and the ungodly appear? Man, we can't afford to bow for the sake of these people. They'll fight you now. They're going to come at you with all kind of stuff about you judging, you this, you that. Don't bow. Send them an email and show them. Go to Pimp Preacher and copy and paste and shoot it to them. They're going to call you back. What you send me this mess for? See, you judging this man. Did you listen to it? Yeah, I listened to it. Okay, that's good. I'll see you. Bye. It's in you now. It got you now. It's in you. Say, look, let me leave you with this last word. You know that's crazy. And you know that mess. You know that's mess. And you know that's a bunch of junk. And you know you're kidding yourself. Bye. Now they got to deal with you. They got to deal with it. You get up the phone cussing. What you cussing for? I thought you were saved. Then they get up. I can't stand them. They don't. But see, they know. Inside, they know. See, you know. You got a truth detector built into you. You know. This is not right. But all that's got to happen for this thing to blow like an atomic bomb, somebody to see you. Go on your job. When they're talking about you, say, y'all know that's. See, you got to go back. Look, this is what you got to revert back to. Stop all. You got an education. You went to college. I think Melanie went to Spelman, and so she went to Clark. And can't all that. Can't lose all that. Go back to the hood that you was brought up in when you was about 13 and you was cussing them jokers out when they tried to touch you, and you that boy touched you at the pool and you were cussing them. You cussed them out, in and out, over and out, tenfold over and out. I ain't telling you to start cussing, but what I'm saying is go back to that same you back then. You lose all this political correctness and tact and just let a joker know, hey, look, y'all. Y'all know that's crazy. Have y'all lost y'all mind up in here? What's wrong with you? You know that joker taking, stealing that money. He did that. Don't say that, because they won't hear that. Say that. Don't say that, because they're going to blow you off. This. He did that. Y'all crazy. Don't be letting nobody game you. We came together in the hood. You were right down. You were two doors down from me. When you remember, we used to smoke. I ain't gonna break my pad. We used to smoke dope. We were running women. We was at the club. And now you acting crazy. Come on, man. See, they can hear that. They can hear that. Just revert back to type, man. Stop trying. They taught you this junk in school to make you a world citizen, to make you adaptable and make you fit into the mold. Break out of the mold and don't bow. Can't you see the Hebrew boy say, hey, king, I ain't careful to answer you in this. I don't know what God to do, but I know this. I ain't going to bow. See, I got to end this message with, and tell the devil you're not going to bow. But no, that's not what I'm saying. Tell the devil, I ain't gonna bow. You pimp, you punk, you sissy, I ain't gonna bow. Can you? Forget you. That's how you gotta go in, man. Have your mouth ugly. Be just tore up. That's how you get into this, man, if you want to be saved. Lord, we thank you for this time of sharing. Thank you for the word of God. Thank you for catapulting us into another realm. We're not going to bow. The Bible says laughter is like medicine. It's good for the soul. But it's a serious time. We got to deal with serious matters. But at the same time, we're going to stay free. Gonna enjoy life. Gonna live. We're commanded to live. The Bible said you say you found somebody in blood and squander and squalor and just in rags, and you said, I said to them, live. I command you to live. They went to the tomb and the angel said, look, he's not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. Why do you look for Jesus amongst the dead? These clowns want us to die. They want you beat down. They want you emaciated and dried up and hopeless. They want you with your eyes cast down, feeling bad about yourself and incapacitated, with that thing down in your guts that's just eating away at you at life, and it's just pitiful, it's hurtful, and I can't raise my head. The devil is a liar. Why should I let some devil incapacitate me? Man, live. Child, live. Woman, live. Girl, live. Boy, live. I command you to live. Bowing down to a stinking Sodomite prince. The prince of Sodom came to Abraham before Melchizedek, talking about, give me the souls and you keep the goods. Abraham said, the devil is a liar. I'm not giving you anything. And I don't want you giving me anything so that you'll say that you gave me something. The king of Sodom showed up first. Satan came strolling through before Melchizedek, wanting you to bow. God, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, let us shred off these graveyard clothes, lose this programming given to us through institutionalized teaching for over 13 to 16, 18 years of our lives, taught by a system to make us easily entreated and manageable, programmed and brainwashed by them, so we wouldn't cause any troubles for the empire. That's why they set up public schools. To acclimate you, to make you civil, so you live amongst the civilized people in civilization. Now it's time to stir some trouble. It's time to kick some stuff over. It's time for the body of Christ to go on display. It's time not to accommodate. It's time to be a revolutionary. It's time to take it to the streets as a minister of the Most High. It's time to stop apologizing for being saved. God, in the name of Jesus, raise up the church. Come against this spirit. They're trying to make sodomy normal. They're trying to make homosexuals and lesbians normal. They're trying to make transgender people normal. They're trying to create unisex restrooms for everybody. So you stand there next to a man in a restroom as a woman. No gender, unisex, everybody the same. Now they got college dorms where you can just come to school and whatever gender you end up with, that's just a roll of the dice. It doesn't matter. Your young girl at 18 can be in a room with another boy that's 18, never met him before in life. It's unisex. The academic guys, the brainy guys, the intelligentsia. God. The Greeks. That's the mind of the Greeks. That's their philosophical, humanistic mind. But the Bible says, the sons of Greece rise up and they conflict with the sons of Zion. We are the sons of Zion. We are the children of Jerusalem. We belong to a heavenly city whose builder and maker is God. God, I curse that spirit that's gone forth through the words of these pimps in this city. This city right here is just like Corinth. It's full of mega churches. You got Dollar, you got Long, you got Morton, you got all these guys. You got all these guys just enveloping this city, preaching that prosperity, beating them down with the tithe, trying to make them have all the money come up front. They're driving around in Bentleys and Rolls Royces and flying around in Lear Jets. They're living off the people's backs. It's time to see the body of Christ come together in a unified fashion that's going to present Christ to the nations. No big me's, no little lies. No big me's, no little you's. No big you's, no little me's. It's all about Christ. Leadership is a position of servanthood. You wash the feet. You do the tasks that are necessary to see the people advancing. Paul says, death works in me so that life can be imparted to you. Bring servants like that to lead church. I pray for these guys that are really called. I pray for the women that are really called, that they raise up and they become vessels of honor, fit for the master to use. Not lords over God's inheritance, but servants. And I know you're faithful to bless people that you use and that are fruitful and that are before you. God is not stingy. You don't have to try to make people give and make people try to support you. God takes on that responsibility. In due season, in sundry times, in diverse manners, you've always provided for the needs of people. God, let's break out of this. Whatever this is, it's like a plastic bag, like a garbage bag you're trying to punch your way out of it that won't break. Get us out of here. I'm tired of being confined by this old stinking, filthy spirit that claims to represent God and yet it hates God. Nebuchadnezzar, with his stinking golden image, set the captives free. Do a work that's going to cause the ears of the people to tingle. God's moving through here now. I believe in God. I believe in one God. I believe in Jesus Christ, his son. I believe in one apostolic faith. I believe that the Holy Ghost has come down from heaven to empower us and to fill us. I believe that the Holy Ghost leads us into all truth. I believe that God has more power than the devil. I believe that a truth told has more power than a lie. I believe the hypocrite must finally emaciate in the presence of God. I believe that God has a people called out by name that will hear his voice and won't follow the voice of another. I believe that the finances are available for the church as it's reformed outside of this heinous, filthy religious camp. I believe that multitudes will be drawn by the Spirit to a real saving faith in Jesus Christ. God, it's time, high time, to curse the devil and raise up people that can be used by you to multiply after their own kind. Man, life begets life. If God saves you and fills you, why in the world would you sit on it? Who would neglect, the Bible says, such a great salvation? It's time to put hands to the plow and get in that field and labor as a minister of God, bringing forth the children of God. It'll be amazing how many people could be saved if people got on about the Father's business. By way of Stick'em, man, multiply. Send people to the website. Get a contingent going. Meet in your homes. Expand the borders in your home. You'll be amazed at how many people are looking for. They're looking for the truth. Here in this city, they're wandering to and fro, not knowing what to do. Like sheep without a shepherd. We'll take on the responsibility of the leading edge. But hey, we're not the ones. You are the ministers. You feed the sheep. You teach the Bible studies around your kitchen table. You put together prayer meetings in your home. They were never threatened. The apostles were never threatened. The Bible said they went house to house and town to town teaching the gospel. That said, they had meetings in their homes and people had Bible studies and they had assemblies in their homes. They weren't threatened by a church home. They weren't threatened by people meeting in their homes. Y'all got to come down here to the tabernacle, now to the temple, to the church. We didn't authorize y'all to meet up here by yourself. You don't know nothing about this now. Well, I'm the preacher. Now, you a clown. God, if you've ever done anything for anybody, do this. Do this. Flow through us. Get this done. Break the back of the devil. Set the captive free. Let us revert back to ourselves. Not trying to look like anybody. Not trying to be defined by what the world said I should look like to accommodate them. Trying to tell you, look, you don't have any couth. You're uncouth. Yeah, I'm uncouth and I'm going to stay uncouth. And I'm casting the devil out of you as an uncouth guy. It's time to stop letting them define what's right, what's tactful, what's appropriate. Telling me how to sip my tea with one pinky up. Man, look, God, why are we conforming to this world as opposed to being transformed by the renewing of our minds? Release us. Let the decree come down from heaven right now. Release the people. Tell Pharaoh to let your people go. And break a bat over his head. And bring the people up out of here. We will not bow. We will not bow. In Jesus' name. By Stick'em, everybody listening, get behind this. You see where we're going. We're not here to build another mega ministry. You don't see my name on the ministry. It's not on purpose. I don't have a church. I might be in Istanbul, Turkey by this time tomorrow morning. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what I'm about to do. You can't put weight down on folks being an idiot. I got to die. Why don't you build something with your name on it? What if you die? Now what? When I raise my son up to take it on over. It's just a family-run business. That's all it is. And he's a junior, so I don't have to change the name of the ministry, so his name would just still fit in. It was Kenneth Hagin. Now it's Kenneth Hagin Jr. Now it's Kenneth Hagin III next after him. So we don't even have to change the name. This is all garbage. The church in Antioch, the church at Corinth, the church at Laodicea, the church at Philippi. You don't see Paul's evangelistic ministry moving through the scene. This is foolishness. This is stupidity. We're going to make another move. Our plan, if God will just bless it, is to move out and establish teaching centers to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. With a staff of elders that govern the church, not one man. You don't find one man governing the church in the Bible. You have elders that govern the church. You might have a shepherd that is a man that teaches consistently. But there's a governing body in a church to keep it. Elders, deacons, pastors, and teachers. He says, man, God sets up a church. He says, first he sets in the church prophets. Then he said, adds on apostles. Then see, he sets it up like he sees fit. But it's never under a man's personality. It's never personality driven. A man or a woman teaching the gospel correctly will drive you away from them toward Christ and tell you, look, you're responsible. You better get to Jesus and pray through. You better spend some time fasting and reading your Bible. And you better get personally responsible for him, because you're going to be judged for every mortal deed you did in your body. And he's not going to ask you about any preacher, because you got a will and common sense he gave you. And you don't come there talking about the woman that you gave me, the pastor that you gave me. He told me. He's going to ask you, didn't you have a Bible? Didn't you have a mind to think? Didn't I give you sense and logic? Don't talk to me about nobody else. God, folk better get for real in these last days. God, we just ask you right now for real. This is real now. This is the real thing now. Hey, whatever you got to do, do it. But we got to see the church come out of this thing home free. Home free. Not enamored with and encumbered with any outside junk. We don't need to be dependent on their money, their stuff, their resources. We don't need to be renting anything from them. We got to be home free. We're directly identifying with Christ on the vertical. He provides. And he gives us what to do, and he gives the resources for it. God, we got to break free from these jokers. We got to break free from these clowns, this junk, this trash. It's messed up so many people over the years. We watched them since the 80s just be messed up. People we've known that got saved the same time we got saved, incapacitated to this very day by the false gospel. We're talking 25 years in a prison camp. And still can't see it. That's not right. They stand between you and the people. They don't want to let your people go. Just as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these resist the truth. But now their folly is being revealed to all men. Set people free. As we don't bow, use that as a catalyst as we go through the fire to promote the real church. We stood the test. We went through the fire. The bondage was burned off of us. Now it's time to stand and proclaim the words of God. In Jesus' name. And we thank you for it. Amen.